Good morning. We actually have one more minute, but we're going to start. I don't have a whole lot of announcements. I just wanted to bring you up to date on the class. Went well. I was just explaining to Don and Richard that our classes are exactly the same books and everything else that all of the MDivs, who are the people who live on campus and do the normal route of becoming a pastor. But we do ours in 4 days. What they do in a semester, we get the 4 days of lectures, but all the same books and reading materials, and then the same ending assignment of the 5 papers that we have to write at the end. So there it is in a nutshell. I survived the class, and so now I have to write the papers. So anyway, on the last day he said, so there's two things that are very problematic. He's from Guyana, so he's Guyana. The first is that we're going to have to have an extra hour and a half of class this afternoon because we had been asking so many questions that he got behind on his agenda for the class. So we were there till 3:30 instead of getting out at 2, but that really didn't bother so much. People are not encouraged to have any flights on that afternoon anyway. They're told that they should wait until Friday morning because this happens in classes all the time that you get delayed of getting out. But, and so all that meant was that I got home a little later and my drive home. But it's also kind of fun because I kind of decompressurize as I drive home. I talk to myself the whole way. And the evening before, I'd read through my text and had kind of been formulating a sermon all the way home in the car. So what you get today is kind of part of that and part of what I thought about otherwise when I got home on Friday and was there. So, but it all works out. The other thing that he said was, the good news was that we were, instead of having our final papers due on Valentine's Day, he thought that was very bad of him to make that wonderful lovey day to be when our final papers were due. He gave us an extra week. Ta-da! So they're due on the 21st of February instead of the 14th. So that was kind of nice. You will find in your places today, or if you want more, there's some out on the little table by the bulletin board, annual reports for the last year. If you would like to take one to someone that you know that needs one. And there are also copies of the minutes. Actually, the minutes are what's in your place in where you're sitting. So. But there are extra of those too. There's extra copies of the minutes. And if we run out, we'll make more copies. So don't be afraid to take, if it's the last one, just let us know that you took the last one so that we can make more. And thank you to Lee for providing all of that good stuff for us. I don't have any birthdays this week, which is kind of strange, I think. I don't think I do. No, I don't think so. Nobody has a birthday this week. I suppose we could just pretend, and whenever someone's birthday comes along, we'll pretend it's your birthday or whatever, but whatever happens. Anybody else have any other announcements? Next week will be communion. The week after that, when we have our annual meeting or when the majority of people are here, we'll do some installation of the officers. So if you happen to know that you're going to be gone a certain week, let me know that so that I can figure out how all that'll happen. And other than that, that's all I know. Please stand for the confession and forgiveness. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your holy name, amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. You may be seated. We sing our first hymn, Songs of Thankfulness and Praise. Songs of thankfulness and praise, Jesus, Lord, to thee we raise. Manifested by the star to the sages from afar, branch of royal David's stem, in thy birth at Bethlehem, anthems be to thee addressed, God in flesh made manifest. Manifest at Jordan stream, prophet, priest, and king supreme, and at Cana wedding guest, in thy Godhead manifest. Manifest in power divine, changing water into wine, anthems be to thee addressed, God in flesh made manifest. Manifest in making whole, weakened body, fainting soul. Manifest in valiant fight, quelling all the devil's might. Manifest in gracious will, ever bringing good from ill. Anthems be to thee addressed, God in flesh made manifest. Please stand. Grant us peace to thee, Lord, present in holy word. Grace to imitate thee now, and be pure as pure art thou, that we might become like thee. Continue with setting 10 on page 203. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all and also with you. Have mercy on us, Lord, and hear our solemn prayer. We come to saves us from despair. Have mercy on us, Christ, and wash mercy on us, Lord. Make sin and shame depart. Renew us with your saving power. Create in us new hearts. Saints and angels bow before you. Here on earth our songs we raise. Glory be to Christ forever, Lamb of God and Lord of love, Son of God and gracious Savior, you have come from heaven above. On the cross you died to save us. Now you reign at God's right hand. Hear our prayer, restore, forgive us. In your promise firm we stand. Holy One, we now acclaim you. Lord, alone to you we call. Holy One, in faith we name you, God Most High, yet near to all. Jesus Christ, with God the Spirit, in the Father's splendor bright. For the peace that we inherit, glory be to God on high. We pray the prayer of the day together, and we're using the January 30th. Almighty and ever-loving God, increase in us the gifts of faith and hope and love, that we may obtain what you promise. Make us love what you command through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. We're using the majority of the bulletin for today, but the gospel lesson will be a combination of last week and this week's papers. So the psalm for today is Psalm 71. You may respond with the bold print verses. In you, O Lord, have I taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me and set me free. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be my strong rock, a castle to keep me safe. You are my crag and my stronghold. Deliver me, my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the clutches of the evildoer and the oppressor. For you are my hope, O Lord God, my confidence since I was young. I have been sustained by you ever since I was born. From my mother's womb you have been my strength. My praise shall always be of you. The second reading for today comes from the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians. And I'm beginning with verse 4. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. And when I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I only know in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel. Alleluia, Lord and Savior, open now your saving word. Let it burn like fire within us, speak until our hearts are stirred. Alleluia, Lord, we sing for the good news that you bring. The Holy Gospel according to the fourth chapter of Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee. And a report about him spread throughout all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then Jesus began to say to all in the synagogue, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did in Capernaum.'" And he said, "Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them except to a widow at Zephathah in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove Jesus out of the town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But Jesus passed through the midst of them and went on his way. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Grace, love, and peace to you from God, the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to think back to a time, possibly even maybe before you attended church here, to when pastors were shared with numerous congregations, not just two or maybe three, but many congregations. And they made this happen by making the rounds with a horse and buggy, maybe even eventually by a car. That is how Jesus and the disciples went about spreading the good news that Jesus had come, that Jesus, the Messiah, was the one that the people had been waiting for. And they'd been waiting for a long time. In this Gospel of Luke, Jesus then claims his identity as he begins his public ministry and eventually even gets back to his hometown. Being the guest rabbi, he's asked then to read the scripture for the day and give the message. And as Jesus stands to read, he's handed the scroll of Isaiah, and he chooses the place to begin to read. "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." This Spirit, present at baptism, our baptism, and also the baptism of Jesus, as we remember, came down like a dove from heaven. During the temptations and the testing that the Satan did with Jesus, encouraging him to jump off or to turn the stones into bread and etc. And now the Spirit is present at this very moment when Jesus is claiming his identity, that he is the one. He's the one that's been anointed to proclaim freedom, recovery of sight, to set the oppressed free. So which category of that do you fit into? The poor? Those in captivity? Are you physically blind? Or maybe have some other physical ailment? Are you powerfully suppressed? We know from the books of the Old Testament that in many times the people of Israel were over and over and over again part of this group. Big armies of people went in and took them captive and took them away, many of them away from their homes and had them in captivity. So they were released eventually and went back to their hometowns and their places and rebuilt their temples. But so we know that this group of people, this group of Israelites was at least included. They were suppressed. They possibly had all kinds of other problems. But was it only meant for them? Or is the word of God, the word of that's there, the Jesus that we know, only meant for that few little people that were talked about by the prophets of old? What about you? Does it seem like maybe this doesn't apply to you right here and now in 2022? That's where I was thinking on my way home in the car. Maybe we need to let these words transform a little bit more so that now they can come into our physical being and into our brains so that we can ingest them more as this, with our ears that we listen, but sometimes it takes a while, at least for mine, to get inside there and stay there. To let those words come to life in some different ways. There are a lot of ways that we are imprisoned, other than being in jail or in prison ourselves. Self-doubt. I have a lot of that. I don't think I'm worthy of God's call to be a pastor. I sit and I think about, no, this couldn't possibly be. I can't possibly do this. I just can't seem to do. I can't seem to think. I can't seem to remember. Expectations for what we can or cannot do on our own. We think we can do it all by ourselves. We don't need God. What do we need God for? We can do this. No, we need God, the Spirit, God the Father, God the Son, all the time to get through all that we have to endure. What others expect of you, or what I can do, or what I cannot do, or maybe the same is upon you. Whether those people are expecting more of you or less of you, whatever that is, maybe it's where you work, maybe it's just in your own household, maybe it's whatever. What's expected of you? Where are your priorities? Are they out of whack? Personal priorities or the work priorities, or what's taking top, and why do we put that there, and why are we prioritizing this over this? Exhaustion. We are tired and we are weary. It's been a long haul these 2 years. Do you realize we're coming up again on this March 15th date that it's going to be 2 years since we've been in this pandemic? We're tired. We're tired of trying to figure out what's the best thing that we should do. How can we make it the best for all of the people that we are involved with? And then there's the fear. The fear that creeps in, and maybe we didn't do that right. What if this could happen? What if that could happen? The fear is always there. And disease, all kinds of things going on. Diabetes, cancer, dementia, ALS. People are having struggles. We just had a Zoom yesterday about the American Cancer Society, and there is no research right now going on with cancer because there's no money being funded from the government. All the government things have not been done. There's no budget, so there's no cancer research. And that really irritates some of us, because I think they need to be continuing with cancer research. And there's other things too, not just the cancer side of it, but there's diabetes and there's other things, ALS things. All kinds of things are not being looked at anymore and researched because there's no money to fund the research. There's too small an understanding of what God can do sometimes as well, and of what God is doing. So where did you find yourself in all of those weird thoughts that I had as I was putting them into my dictaphone thing? I push a button and then the phone records it. What is your imprisonment? We are really tired, and we're really weary of this pandemic. We know that until everyone is free of this virus, nobody's free. So how can we be saved from our imprisonment from this virus? Maybe that's why, as at least right now, we want everything to be free. We want people to be free from all of the problems that they have. All of those that I listed. Wouldn't it be cool if all of those would just go away? And the hospitals could be more like what they used to be, so that if you got sick, you could actually go to the hospital and find that there's room for you there, instead of having to drive 60 or 80 or 100 more miles to find a hospital that could take you in, so that there's a room for you to be cared for. We know that there's even families that are having dissension and arguments amongst themselves because not everyone has the same ideas about whatever it is, be it the virus or other social things that are happening, other opinions. But the good thing is that we still hear the promises in the gospel message. We have the need to be set free from anger at those who are thinking differently than we do. To not make this into a us versus them thing. To have empathy for those who are suffering, to be set free from fear and weariness and exhaustion. Because God wants us to be free. God wants justice and righteousness restored. And the best news of all is that Jesus says freedom is actually here. Eternal life is here. We're already living in the kingdom, right here, today, in 2022. So hear that message. Hear that eternal life is here. Hear that we are living the life that Jesus wants us to live. Believe that message. Jesus died and rose so that we could have that message of eternal life. And now we can live that message. Amen. Our hymn is, O Word of God Incarnate. Please stand as we confess our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance, so we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. Guide your church in the ways of faith, hope, and love. Cultivate ministries and communities of compassion that bear witness to your enduring presence among us. God of grace, hear our prayer. Teach us to live in humility on the earth. Curb arrogance that leads to destruction of natural resources and disregard for future generations. Inspire the work of scientists who urge us to live in harmony with your creation. God of grace, hear our prayer. You are the refuge of all who seek hope and freedom. Accompany immigrants, refugees, and asylum seekers who cross borders to find safety and opportunity. Embolden leaders to draft compassionate policies on behalf of migrants and those who assist them. God of grace, hear our prayer. Love bears, believes, hopes, and endures all things. Comfort with your love all who are lonely, fearful, or brokenhearted. Sustain the hope of all those who suffer in body or spirit. Especially we pray for Scott and Connie Arian and anyone else who we name now aloud or silently. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your grace falls upon young and old alike. Bless the gifts of children in this congregation and in this community. Give us humble hearts to follow their leadership. Inspire us with their laughter, their insights, and their curiosity. God of grace, hear our prayer. We praise you for those who have gone before us and now see you face to face. Especially today, we pray for the family of Nick Heckman. Abide with us in this mortal life until we rest in the arms of your never-ending love. God of grace, hear our prayer. Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all of our prayers to you in confidence and faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Please remain standing as we receive our offering.
We give thee but thine own, whate'er the gift may be. All that we have is thine alone, a trust, O Lord, from thee. May we thy bounties thus, as stewards true, receive, and gladly as thou blessest us, to thee our first fruits give.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, sovereign of the universe. You offer us new beginnings and guide us on our journeys. Lead us to offer ourselves and these our gifts for your work. Prepare us to carry your love to a hungry world. In the name of Christ, our light. Amen. And now, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now receive the blessing. The Lord bless you.